This is lecture one. Of physics 210A. Thermal physics. And in this course, we will be considering thermodynamics of systems. So to start with, let me give you the references that I'll be following in the next few lectures. It'll be chapters 1, 2, and 3 of Dittman-Zemansky. So just to motivate you, what is thermodynamics? And why is it so important? Thermodynamics is a science that describes relationships at macroscopic scale. So just to put in a nutshell, it is a science that describes relationship between macroscopic quantities and their dynamics. It appears to be a very simple statement, but it has a lot of subtlety in it. What it means is that these general relationships exist irrespective of what the microscopic details of the system are. So it can be applied to a variety of systems, irrespective of what kind of microscopic dynamics is taking place. One of the best examples I can cite on this is that Wien could arrive at the general formula of black body radiation based purely on thermodynamic arguments. So that way, it is a very powerful science and gives you very powerful relationships. So let me just write a few definitions when I say what it describes relationship between macroscopic quantities. What is macroscopic scale? So this is, in general, we would say, is the scale that relates to humans and things around us and their size. So we want to describe anything in thermodynamics related to quantities which are measurable at this scale. On the other hand, contrast this with microscopic scale. That is, what happens here is governed by how atoms, molecules behave. And the related quantities change according to Newton's laws or quantum mechanical laws. So, when doing thermodynamics, I'm not really worried about how these atoms and molecules, what kind of interaction they have, what kind of, collisions they're having. All that is averaged out in terms of some macroscopic quantity. For example, in a gas or a liquid, we'll be talking in terms of pressure. We'll be talking in terms of volume or the internal energy of the system. And that, on an average, takes care of this microscopic detail, and rest is then related through thermodynamic laws. So if I were to just make a chart between macroscopic and microscopic, so let me just make it here, macro versus micro. So you would say in macro, we do description by few state variables. And in micro, the corresponding thing would be description by a large number of variables. For example, I would have pressure here, and the corresponding thing in micro would be momentum transfer by molecules. Here I would have volume. Corresponding thing in microscopic would be position of individual particles. Here I would have density. Microscopic picture, it will be collection of delta functions. Here I would have temperature or related quantity, heat. And by now you know this is related to kinetic energy of individual particles. So you see there's a difference between macro versus micro, and you can see that when we give a macroscopic description, I'm reducing the number of variables by large, a huge, huge amount, from 10 days to 23 to 2 or 3. And what we do is that when we give this macroscopic quantities, these are some sort of an average of these microscopic quantities. And just to make the point further, when I talked about pressure, that's the macroscopic quantity, and corresponding microscopic quantity is momentum transfer by molecules. So this is often derived. You take a wall, and all these molecules are bouncing off the wall. So they apply force, and then you average over all this force. The average force is the pressure. Area, which is momentum transfer per unit time, per unit area, is the pressure. So you have transferred from that huge number of momentum transfer by each molecule per unit time to pressure, which is average force by these molecules. So thermodynamic quantities are time and space averaged. Space average of microscopic quantities. So, if again I look at this molecules hitting the wall, what you would find is that if I were to plot force versus time, each molecule would be giving a force like this, a spike, if you like. And so force would be fluctuating, and what you really measure is this pressure, which is the average force. So this is how you make a transition from microscopic quantities to macroscopic quantities. Microscopic quantities show a lot of fluctuation. And macroscopic quantities are averaged out. So they are sort of, you know, pressure is a given number. But if you measure the force by each molecule, it will be fluctuating quite a lot. So that's the difference. So let's now write down a few more macroscopic quantities that we'll be using. And these are, say, for a gas, pressure P, volume V, temperature T. Now, just to show you the generality, we can talk about a dielectric. And this would be described by an electric field in it. Then its polarization and temperature T. You see, thermodynamics comes in, temperature comes in, because if you notice, for example, in your mobile battery, it gets heated up. So somewhere there is this heat exchange, temperature comes into picture. Similarly, I can talk about a magnet, which has variables, magnetic field, then there's magnetization, and temperature T. So there are three systems that I have given you that have this. Now, another example I can just write is superconductors. There's a lot of thermodynamics related to superconductors, and if I get a time, I'll go into that also. So let me now just give you a few quantities and concepts that you're familiar with, but I should state them once more, that we'll be using. So, quantities and concepts to be used in thermodynamics. So first concept, and it is related to what I said earlier, that in thermodynamics, we talk about macroscopic quantities, which are time averaged, space averaged, and remain constant. They don't fluctuate. So what we mean by that is that we're talking necessarily about equilibrium situation. And we'll be considering those only. Even if the system is changing from one to the other, it'll be going from one to the other, we'll take it through many, many different equilibrium situations. So this is a very important concept. And since the system has to change, that change is known as quasi-static. That means it is kept almost static, but cannot be completely static, then it will not change. So quasi-static. So the kind of equilibrium we talk about are thermal equilibrium. We can talk about mechanical equilibrium. And when both are there, they're called thermodynamic equilibrium. The next concept is that of heat and temperature. So we just say that heat is the form of energy that is transferred between two parts of a system, or between two systems when their temperature are different. So this kind of defines both heat and temperature. If some energy is being transferred, you know, you feel hot, cold, that's the temperature. And because of that temperature change, there's some energy transferred, which is known as heat. And this is also then related to zeroth law of thermodynamics, which talks about thermal equilibrium. So what we're going to say is, if in a system no heat is transferred, between any of its portions, parts then there is thermal equilibrium. And system is said to have the same temperature. We can also say is it has uniform temperature. So this a quantity being uniform is an essential part of equilibrium. For example, if there's mechanical equilibrium between two gaseous systems, then one would say that the pressure is the same throughout. So this uniformity of quantities is a signature of equilibrium of a system. Next, I want to discuss is the work and internal energy. First, we will take work to be positive if the work is done on a system. So if I'm doing work on a system, that means I'm pumping in energy. So this implies work is positive if by doing work I am pumping energy into the system. So, for example, in the gas system, we'll take work dW. I'll just put a dash here to show that it could be path dependent. It's going to be minus P dV. Because if the volume is decreasing, that means I'm doing work on the system. And then minus P dV becomes positive. And related quantity to that is the internal energy. For this, if a system is isolated from its surroundings so that it exchanges no heat or any energy with it, then work done in going from initial state I to final state F is found to be path independent. That means no matter how I go from initial state to the final state, the work would be the same. And this implies that through this, what I'll call adiabatic work, that means work being done so that there's no heat exchange with the surroundings, so adiabatic work, we can define a state function. That means that depends only on the state and not the path. Something like the potential energy of a system in which the work done is independent of the path, the potential energy difference is the work done, no matter what path you take. And this state function is going to be known as the internal energy of the system. So this state function U is known as the internal energy. So UF minus UI is equal to dW adiabatic, independent of the path. This defines internal energy. Historically, this was a major triumph of thermodynamics to recognize that a system has something called the internal energy. And therefore, only the heat and work themselves do not completely give the system their difference, actually makes some contribution to this internal energy in the system, and that came in the form of first law. So let me state that also right here. So first law then tells you that the change in the internal energy is going to be dq plus the work done on the system. Both are state functions. So both heat taken to be positive if supplied to the system, and work done on the system increase its internal energy. So you're very familiar with the law for the gas, where you write du equals dq. Now, work done, we have said, is minus P dV for the gas. So what you've seen, this law as dq equals du plus P dV in your 11th, 12th thermodynamics. So that's what it is. We just written in a general form so that you understand what's going on physically. If I give heat to a system, I'm increasing its internal energy. If I'm working on the system, I'm increasing its internal energy. The total increase in the internal energy is equal to the sum of that heat supplied plus the work done, and that gives you the first law. Now let us look at some systems which we'll be dealing with and what kind of work done is there. Work done in some known systems. One, we have already seen gas. Let me just make this symbolically. Pressure P, volume V, then dW equals minus P dV. Two, suppose there's a wire fixed on a wall and I'm stretching it by applying a force F. Then work done is going to be equal to F dL, where dL is the change in the length of the wire. This could also be part of a rubber band. And you see, if you take a rubber band and, you know, pull it back and forth, then you can change its temperature. So again, thermodynamics at work. We are doing some work. We are changing its internal energy. Where that internal energy is coming from, what it is, I don't care. There's some microscopic detail. But finally, I end up changing that internal energy. That is changing the temperature. Then I could also have liquid surface and suppose the area is A and it is increased by delta A, then the amount of work I'll be doing will be equal to gamma, where gamma is the surface tension, dA. Gamma is the surface tension. So when I stretch a water or a liquid surface, I put work into it and I increase its internal energy. How the temperature and everything will be related would be given by the first law. Then I would have a dielectric slab. Why I'm taking a slab is taking a simple geometry where if I want to learn about the thermodynamics of a system, it's good to have a very simple geometry. So in this case, we'll have a slab sitting in a parallel plate capacitor where a voltage V is applied. So if voltage is increased, then the work done, dW, or some with that voltage, some dielectric properties change, or something is done so that some charge is pumped in, then dW is going to be the voltage which is there times the charge which is coming in. And this work would be split into two parts. Work in increasing electrical energy plus work done on dielectric. So if we do that, then you work out different steps and you find that the work done will come out to be electric field in the system, D, total polarization, P. Notice that we are trying to write it in terms of quantities related to dielectric alone. The voltage has been taken away, everything else has been taken away. So we see the electric field in the dielectric is E, it's polarization dP, and the work done will be E dP. And keeping this geometry simple, E is taken to be uniform inside. If I do an experiment, I'll do experiment in such a way that the electric field is uniform inside. Then we'll talk about magnetic work on a paramagnetic sample. What we mean by that is that the magnetization is proportional to applied field H. There is no hysteresis, nothing. Again, what we are going to do is take a solenoid, put this dielectric material or the paramagnetic material inside so that things are uniform, and calculate the work done if I increase the current by dI. If I do that, the magnet, there'll be a back EMF, and then I want to calculate the total work done and write finally the work in terms of field and magnetization. And if I do that, I'll find that the work done on a paramagnetic sample comes out to be H Just a note here, check if I am missing a mu naught here. So these are different kind of systems where I've shown what kind of work is done, and I can apply first law in all this. So I can write that the internal energy of any of the system would be changing according to the heat supplied or taken away, heat supply, plus dW. And dW is going to be different according to what system we're talking about. So it's going to be dQ minus P dV for gas is going to be dQ plus F dL for a stretched wire is going to be equal to dQ plus E dP for dielectric, dQ plus H dm for magnetic material equal to dQ plus gamma dA for liquid surface, and so on. So this law is general. As long as I can define work, that gives me internal energy when work is performed in adiabatic form, and then I can just write this law. So let me conclude today's lecture by saying that we have discussed that thermodynamics is a science relating macroscopic quantities without worrying about the microscopic details. Microscopic quantities are fluctuating, macroscopic quantities are averaged out, they're constant with time, changes take place through quasi-static processes, and that's what we'll be doing in equilibrium thermodynamics, or the thermodynamics we'll be learning in this case. Thank you.